said. This is the third Sunday after the season of Pentecost, and I want to begin by saying Happy Father's Day to all you dads out there. In fact, without the moms and the kids, there would be no fathers, so I guess it's fair to say that we could wish all of you a Happy Father's Day, and I hope it's a blessed one for you today. I just have two things I want to announce. One is that we have that ongoing challenge through the month of July, where the high school graduates have challenged the congregation in honor of their 2020 graduation date to bring in 2020 food items for the little pantry to help with the poor in the community. And I'm happy to tell you we've gotten over 800 items already. So we're well on our way, but we have a ways to go, and I'm sure we'll make it just fine. The other thing I want to let you know is that we have assigned a group of people called the Reopening Task Force. Wonderful people representing all of us to think about when is the safest and how is the safest way to reopen our church for worship. It'll be a while, as we all know, because we're following the rules from the state and from the CDC and from the Wisconsin Council of Churches, all very thoughtful people that are giving us excellent guidance. So together, this task force is going to make a determination about how to do these things and pass that along to the church council, who will then ultimately decide what we'll be doing. But for the time being, we're happy to be offering these live stream services, and I want to thank Katie Robleski as our organist pianist today, and Heidi's here as well, helping out with all of the visuals. We're going to begin this morning with our confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. I'm going to invite you to see the words of confession, the corporate confession on the screen, and say them aloud with us in your home. Thank you. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead to sin and made us alive together with Christ. My friends, now that you have confessed your sins, you need to know that by grace you have been saved, and in the name of Jesus Christ, all of your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now please join together as we sing our opening hymn, Morning Has Broken. The love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we do your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. As we turn to the Word this morning, I want to explain the psalm we're having sung this morning. It's actually a recorded psalm. The psalm is 148. It is first spoken, and then it is sung by a choir, actually quite a large choir. The song is a song that was written by my friend Fred and my friend Ed Wilmington and myself, who worked together on this. And we had it performed at this very large gathering in Los Angeles, the Cathedral. There was this large worship service, and they asked us to do this song for that event. So the song you're about to hear is sung by a large choir directed by another friend of mine, Fred Davison. And it's first spoken and then sung musically. And I hope you'll enjoy this version of Psalm 148.
Sing praise.
Sing praise.
Sing praise, sing praise. From the depths of the earth, from creatures of the deep.
What a great day to praise the Lord. I'm glad you're with us this morning. I'd like to read for you our epistle lesson. This comes from the book of Romans, where St. Paul writes, "Should we continue to live in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The 10th chapter of Matthew, beginning with the 24th verse, "Glory to you, O Lord." Jesus said to the 12, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So, have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many birds. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny them before my Father in heaven. Do not think I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Heavenly Father and the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to begin this morning with a word to the children. Hope you'll snuggle up with your dads this morning because it's Father's Day. I hope you're able to be there with your father. Of course, lots of kids aren't home with their dads right now. Some dads are at work, or some dads are away on business, out of town. Some dads are in the Army and the Navy, and their kids don't get to see them very often these days. Some kids simply don't have fathers in their lives, and that's sad. So if you're home with your dad today, you're very lucky, and I hope that you're going to be close to him and help him out in every way today. Give your dad a hug. Tell your dad how much you love him. That's exactly what he wants. And dads don't want anything more than that, just to know that their children are there for them and they share their love. Sometimes I hear little kids say, they'll say to their dad or maybe their mom, they'll be angry about something and they'll say, "I don't have to do that. You're not the boss of me." Maybe you've said that, or maybe you've heard somebody say that. Well, the thing is, for the little kids that are listening today, we need to be reminded that actually God appointed your father and your mom to be the boss of you for a while. We need help when we're little. We need people to point out the right way, the places to go and not to go, the things to do and not to do. God gave us fathers and moms for just that. So they really are the boss of you for a while. That changes over the years. But when you're very young, you need someone to guard you and take care of you and guide you in all ways. And that's why it's so important today to remember fathers on Father's Day. So I hope you give your dad a big hug and wish him a happy Father's Day and tell him how much you love him. That's what father's like. Now, I start with this Father's Day greeting and mention this to the children because this is a rather difficult reading from the Gospel of Matthew, and really there's not a lot of happiness in it. I'm going to try to work through the text a bit and explain some of this and show how it relates to our day, but nothing much to say about dads in this sermon and in this text. But let's begin looking at this text. And first I want to begin by asking you the question, are you or have you ever been known as a radical? Well, lots of people have become radicals through the years. It seems like radicals usually find themselves in trouble. Oftentimes they make trouble on purpose because of their radical way of thinking and being. Been a lot of radical people rioting a few weeks ago in the midst of all of the peaceful protests that were trying to take place. Some of the young people have been saying, "Wow, this is amazing, this time in our country. There's never been anything like this with the entire nation in an uproar." And again, some of us are older and remember some of these days back when we were protesting against the war in Vietnam, and there were protests that were oftentimes very civil and peaceful, but quite often they became more radical. And the radicals oftentimes wound up in jail for what they were doing, and especially what their violent actions were. The news in 2020 feels a lot like those days in the 1960s. You might remember, some of you, the people that were arrested for rioting outside the Chicago Democratic Convention in 1968. These days look a lot like those. Some people are saying that this has needed in our country to happen for decades. And some people feel like, well, this is a new day with new possibilities. And perhaps now, perhaps finally now, we will work together to bring an end to hatred and racism in our country. And then there are those who feel like this is the same old story, and there is this momentary awareness that will pass away just like it always does, and nothing will have changed. Makes you wonder, where would Jesus have been in all of this? Well, we have to face the fact that Jesus was actually a radical, at least in the way he spoke, not in the way he acted so much, because he was surely not violent, but he was radical in his expectations, and this message today proves that, because he says some very strong things. If it were quoted in court, he would easily be convicted of inciting protests and demonstrations and calling for drastic change. He says, "I came to bring not peace, but a sword." Now, that's not what you expect him to say. That's really the opposite of what you'd expect Jesus to be saying. Shouldn't he be saying, "I have come to bring peace," or "to break the bow, break the bow and shatter the spear," as it says in Psalm 46, "to bring love to neighborhoods, to endear families to one another, to bring reconciliation and not division"? Isn't that what you'd expect Jesus to say? Well, in fact, he does say these things in other places, but not here, not today, not in this reading from the 10th chapter of Matthew. You wonder why. Well, was Jesus having a bad day? Was he in a bad mood? Was he kind of crabby that morning? Well, what is it that he really wants to change so radically. Here's what it is in his day. It was that people should change from following the ugly demands of the Pharisees and those who kept an eye on the law, every jot and tittle of the law. He wanted them to change and follow the command to love one another rather than the law. He wanted people to be forgiving of one another, even their enemies. He wanted people to dare to reach out to those who were unlike them, the poor, the homeless, the unclean, to sit beside a smug and smelly sinner and dare to share a meal with him, is what he called for, or to smile at a harlot and offer her the possibility of dignity rather than seeing her painted face and her painted past, but her promising future. These are the kinds of things that Jesus was actually radical about. Jesus was radical about this kind of love. But that kind of love may come at the expense, he warns us today, at the expense of those who love us, even in your own family, people who are not willing to join us in this radical new way of living. So is there anything that needs to be changed today in our lives? A lot of people have been telling us that there is. And we want to admit that we are here at Trinity a mostly white congregation in a mostly white town in a mostly white part of the country. And people are telling us today, a lot of people are telling us that we all need to acknowledge what they call our white privilege. Do we need to do that? Do you, do I, do all of us? People are telling us today that many people, maybe some of us, display forms of subtle racism. Do I do that? Do you do that? Do we do that as a church, as a community? Some people say that a lot of us harbor a secret mistrust of people unlike us. Do we do this? Now, to hear me say this might make you a little bit angry. But before you dismiss the thought, this is actually a really good time as people call up these things for us to think about. It's a really good time for us to search our hearts. Because in fact, maybe there are things that we're doing and we're not aware of, and maybe there are people in our community who do some of these things. And if we do these things, this is what Jesus wants to change. Today we're observing that people in our nation have decided that this is a time for change. And as followers of Jesus, I think we have to agree. Let there be an end to gross and senseless violence, regardless of whether the person doing it is wearing a black hoodie or a blue uniform. Let there be an end to hatred and racism. Let there be an end to unequal justice. Let there be an end to revenge and abuse and oppression. These are the things that Jesus would say. These are the things that Jesus would preach. These are the things that I think Jesus wants us to stand on the rooftops and shout about. And if these are the things that you are also in favor of, if you are willing to carry your cross in this direction, well, then it is pretty likely that Jesus' prediction will come true. Sometimes someone is going to disagree with you, and that someone might be in your own family, and they may just hate you for what you're saying and doing. And you will see that following Jesus may bring a sword to your relationships and a lack of peace within your own household. That's what Jesus said would happen. I suppose we shouldn't be too surprised if we speak out boldly that it will. Now, as I said, not much of this sounds like very good news on Father's Day. Except that Jesus also says this, those who lose their lives for my sake will find them. To follow Jesus means that some things in our life must die. And when those things are put to death within us, within our hearts, within our words, within our actions, when that happens, then we are among Jesus' forgiven people. And his forgiven people are his greatest treasure. And we know this because of the price that Jesus paid to bring us all home to himself. He said, everyone who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. My friends, let us pray that we will acknowledge Jesus in ways that are visible and bold and effective in our communities. Let us be fathers and sons and mothers and daughters who work together for the beautiful world that Jesus envisions for us. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you ask us to take up our cross and follow where you lead. Sometimes you want to lead us into dangerous places, amongst rioters and looters, amongst people filled with anger and hatred, amongst people who are unclean and distasteful, amongst people who are starving and homeless. Sometimes you lead us where those who love us are unwilling to go. We cannot do these things on our own. Fill us with your Spirit, and let that Spirit cleanse our hearts. Let that Spirit guide us in words and actions that will make a difference in our communities. And let that Spirit always lead us home to you. We pray in your holy name. Amen. And now please join as we sing our song, You Are Mine.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now this morning we will turn to our prayers, and as we've been doing, I'll call out some things that I hope you will be praying for in your homes, whether you pray them aloud or silently in your hearts. We know that God will hear us when we pray for all the people that we know and all the people around the world who have special needs. Today, let's begin by praying that we will learn to listen to diverse voices in the church, in our nation, and in the world. Please pray that by so listening, we might learn from one another and see perspectives vastly different than our own. Let's pray that by listening, we may overcome, we may come to peace and find reconciliation in our nation. Let's pray for God's beautiful creation today, that the fires may cease, that the floods may subside, and that all God's creatures will thrive. Please pray for those who are ill, those with cancer, those with dementia, those with COVID-19, those with other ailments, injuries, and surgeries. We want to remember especially today Rita recovering from surgery. And we just learned of one of our members, Doris, her brother and sister-in-law, both were living at the Bethany home in Waupaca. And sadly, this past week, both of them died from COVID-19. Let us pray this morning for Bob and Beverly Whitman. And let's pray in gratitude for all who provide health care in our community, whether in clinics, hospitals, or elder care facilities. Let's pray today for all those who follow Jesus into dangerous places, speaking out boldly, proclaiming Jesus' love. Let's pray for all those who act boldly to overcome oppression and promote justice. And let's pray with gratitude for the love of the fathers in your life, whether your own or those among your brothers, your sons, your friends, your fathers, whether they are alive and with you, or they have gone on to be with God. And let's also pray for the fathers for whom this day is lonely or difficult. And let us pray with gratitude for God's fatherly mercy that gives us life and that promises us life with him forever. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And let us pray the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, may the peace of Christ be with you always. And may you take a moment to greet those in your household with the peace of Christ, or perhaps to contact others later today and share that peace in a tangible way, so that all will know that Christ is with them. And now please receive this benediction.
God be with you till we meet again. May his face now shine upon you. May he look on you with favor. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet.
Closing song. What a friend we have in Jesus. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.